The HouseDog.com Real Estate Show. I'm Brian Crabtree. Coming up today, beat the mortgage market right now by at least a point, and the $10,000 Biden house tax credit. Will it pass? How do you earn it? Want to buy a new house but want to keep your current 3% interest rate? That's what's holding you back from moving up or moving down? I'll tell you how to do it right now and sort of keep that rate that you've got at 3%. Plus, shopping for a home and using Zillow, why you are being scammed. All that's coming up today. As you all may know, follow my content for the last 25 years or so. I've been on a host of radio stations from WSB in Atlanta to WQSC, WTMA in Charleston, and AM 920, The Answer. And I've decided to kind of consolidate all of that so that I can sit down, record a quick show, give you lots of information, and cut out all the clutter of commercials and advertising and radio formatting and just get straight to the facts. So let's do that today. My website's housedog.com. You can get a free evaluation of your home at housedog.com at any time. Just click on the sell tab. Joe Biden announcing a $5,000 per year housing tax credit. And this would offer $10,000 for certain home buyers if this passes by Congress. And then the president, of course, signs it. This would mostly be for new home buyers who are first-time buyers, an annual tax credit for the first 2 years they own their home of $5,000 to offset the high mortgage costs generated by the Fed policy raising these interest rates, in some cases well into the 7% range. Now, for those of you that don't know this, over the last 4 or 5 years, I have gone from doing full-time housing in Atlanta back to Charleston, still working Atlanta in mortgage and Charleston in mortgage. So I'm in a mortgage business in finance, and I sell houses one-on-one with home sellers, not a team, not some team member, me directly working with home sellers and home buyers in the Charleston, South Carolina market where I've been for 25 years. The biggest problem we face, no matter what market you look at right now, the biggest problem we faced are super high interest rates. Unless you've got a 780 or higher credit score, rates have been flirting with just below or just above 7% range. And at one point, we got to where they were approaching 8% at the kind of the peak of this. And the interest rates are controlled by the 10-year Treasury. Not exactly controlled, but influenced by it. The 10-year Treasury is influenced by the Fed rate policy. So if the Fed overnight funds rate, that's the money that banks lend to each other overnight through the Fed policy rate, that rate goes up, then the 10-year Treasury has to get more attractive to sell, so that rate goes up. And then for mortgage bonds to compete, those rates go up, which means the price of the bond goes down, which means the yield paid on the bond goes up. Is that a lot of information? Yeah, it's a lot of information. It took me a while to learn it. I've been in the business 25 years. It's really when you get in the mortgage business, you start to understand how to predict this stuff. So the typical policies of the current president mirror the housing crisis policies of 2011 and 12. And let's go back to what this kind of tax credit policy does. If this passes, which it might not get through the House, if there's a chance it gets through the Republican House, if this passes and if it's signed and implemented, the $5,000 is a Band-Aid. This is no different than the products out here on the mortgage market right now, which are real simple. If you really want to get a rate in the fours or right around five right now, then the seller does a buy down. There's a lot of houses out there where the seller can do a buy down. And the 2-1 buy down is really simple. The seller pays your interest up front for the next 2 years, or a subsidy of it. So if the interest rate today is 6 7/8, the seller does a 2-1 buy down, and your first year mortgage rate becomes 4 7/8. Now that looks pretty good. Those rates work for the price points in the market. 6 7/8 isn't working so well. So it's really compressing the market, and it's a very big risk for the economy. I think interest rates in today's market, for the housing market to sustain the pricing that it currently has and to continue to grow at a healthy clip, which it has been doing, need to be somewhere in the mid to high fives. 6% kind of is the max. Right now, we're about a roughly a point over that. So this housing credit by Joe Biden is not really a great idea. It's better than nothing, I'll give them that, but it's not really a great idea because what we really need is a Fed policy that takes into account inflation, which they've seemingly gotten under control by the numbers, at least by the metrics they use, not by the ones we use at the grocery store, but they've gotten these under control. So what we really need to be thinking about here is how do we creatively function in this real estate market? You have a home you need to sell, but you've got a 3% interest rate, 3.5, 2.75. What do you do? Well, there's math that works on this. Let's say you've got a $750,000 home somewhere in the Charleston community right now, or anywhere in the U.S. really, and you have a 3% mortgage rate and your payment's $4,000 a month, let's say. And you're thinking about, like, I would like to buy another home. I'd like to downsize because let's say the kids have moved out. They've gone away to college. We don't need this home anymore. So we want to buy a $500,000 home. So what a lot of people look to in this mortgage market is, okay, well, if I buy a $500,000 home and I presently have a $750,000 home or mortgage and that's at 3% and I'm looking at a high sixes rate, well, $500,000 home is basically the same payment in today's mortgage market, or $500,000 mortgage anyway, as a $750,000 home was 2 or 3 years ago. So why move, right? So that's creating a problem with the market from a standpoint of inventory, which is almost a good thing because it's keeping prices inching up. You know, more home prices in the Charleston area last year were up. Even in the face of this mortgage chaos, they were up by like 5-6% on just the overall average numbers. So that's a good thing. But if you look at the average home now that's got a $750,000 mortgage on it, maybe it's worth $1 million. Those things are leasing for $6,000 to $8,000 a month. Well, the mortgage payment's $4,000. So if you take a look at that delta right there, that $2,000, what a lot of people are starting to realize is instead of trying to time the market, which is never a good idea, they can actually take the benefit of their equity, finance a newer, less expensive home, maintain the same payment, get into the new home they want, which goes to the old adage of date the rate, but marry the house, date the rate. You find the house you really want while inventory's a little lagging and slow and there's more negotiation, there's not as many buyers on the market. So you get the best house right now. 2 years ago, it's hard to find the best house, or it was a bidding war. Now, not so much in the bidding war. And so you find the best house, you end up with the same payment on less of a house than you currently have. $500,000, $450,000 or whatever. This is if you're downsizing, especially. This can also work in some parts of the market. Places like Mount Pleasant or Charleston, West Ashley, James Island, it can work just due to the nature of those markets. This can work with an upgrade as well. But it almost always works when you're trying to downsize or make a lateral move. So you make a couple of $1,000s a month in the house you currently own in positive rental income. And then you buy a equal or less expensive house at a higher interest rate. So you either improve your financial scenario because you bought less of a house and your subsidy is coming from your current home that you've rented out for income, which is offsetting that rate increase, or at least there's a neutrality there. Yeah, you've got a 6.5, 6.75, 7% rate on the new house, but you've got the money coming from the old house, the old rental house, pouring in to pay the difference on the higher interest rate. So the net effect is you get to keep a house, equity continues to grow in this house, you buy another house that you really want or that better fits your needs right now, the other house pays the difference in the interest rate, and then you put the rest of the money in your pocket from all these mortgage tricks like a 2-1 buy down, 1-1 buy down, or what have you. And so I can put together a scenario for independent people, and we just do a chart. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, then you don't do it, right? If you can't get what you want and you can't keep the payments in line with what you're comfortable with, then you don't do it. So I'm happy to do this for anyone and just give you a straight answer on it as to what that would look like in your particular needs and wants scenario and financial scenario. Here's the bottom line on this. If you are thinking about selling right now, it's still a good time to sell, especially in some areas. It's not as vibrant as it was 2 years ago, but when you go to buy, it's easier. So you can get a little better deal in terms of what the market will offer instead of having 10 offers on the best houses in the market. Maybe there's just one or two now. It takes a little longer to sell, but we're talking 30, 60 days tops instead of 3 to 6 days tops, which is what we had. Inventory's about double to 2.5 times what it was. So it's still very, very healthy, very good market. Prices are still increasing. And we see really no sign of prices decreasing. There's a lot of concern. A lot of people are chastised. Like, where is my equity? I'm concerned about my equity. I'm worried about my equity. And that is a very valid concern if you lived through in housing the 2008 to 2011 crash. But here's the answer to that. The entire equity scenario in the housing market, based on the quality of the loans that we've been writing for the last decade, high quality, super underwritten, I mean, almost too much. Like the default rate on the loans we've been writing for the last decade is so super low that that is not a concern like it was. Like you could fog a mirror in 2006 and get a loan for $1 million and you only made $5,000 a month. Now you actually have to approve or put and or put significant money down. So these loans aren't going to fall apart. I see no signs of that. What I see is jobs and inflation. So inflation's getting more under control. I know we don't feel that at the grocery store, but by the numbers, there's relief in sight. And when you look at the market, jobs are still really strong. Jobs will control the housing market for the next decade. So if we have a major, major jobs crisis, which we have absolutely no signs of right now, then of course that could highly impact mortgage rates. That would drive up inventory, not mortgage rates, but real estate prices. That would drive up inventory, and over the course of a 1 to 2 year period with a major jobs crisis and continued high interest rates, we would see prices drop by about 20%. That's nowhere near the 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011 crisis. But we have to have that jobs crisis for that to even be kicked off. So you've got lots of time to maneuver in this market with, I hate to say this because I don't like to be this absolute, but with almost no risk of a downside. Like in the next 12 months, I would be absolutely stunned. It would be the biggest miss of my 25-year career predicting this stuff to see prices really truly fall market-wide in any southern market right now, except for a major jobs crisis or if, like in Charleston, Boeing and the Medical University of South Carolina shut down, then okay, we could have a major real estate debacle. But that's just, I just don't see that happening. So when you look at these factors, there's a lot of options for the home buyer right now who may need to be a home seller. Market's great for sellers. It's not so great for buyers if you're using a mortgage, but there are creative solutions to not worry about these interest rates. I mean, a 7% rate over the last 50 years is par. It's average. We just have to find ways to lower your cost. And the rental market of your current home at a 3% rate, it makes no sense to sell that house, to be honest. Some people want to do it. That's fine. I can help you with that. But it makes no sense to sell that house because at that kind of rate, when you put a tenant in there, you're getting free money. You're not paying a mortgage at 3% because that's the rate of inflation. Inflation may be higher than that. So you're actually deflating that mortgage in the terms of how dollars work. Every month you have someone else making that payment and you can go buy another house and live in it. So I just don't see a downside to that. Finally on today's show, and we're going to keep these shows shorter. This is the great thing about, you know, I can get in an hour's worth of radio broadcasting in like 20 to 30 minutes here. So you can get a lot of information quickly that you can use successfully in housing, investing, buying, and selling. One of the things I want to talk about that I have for 15 years, I've talked about Zillow. Zillow has made a migration in the last 3 to 5 years that is quite scary to me from a housing perspective. It speaks to the digital scam society we have. And there are two kinds of scams. There are the phishing scams that get your credit card information, social security number, get credit in your name, run up bills in your name that you have to clean up. That's like the offshore scams, or the guy in their mama's basement in somewhere in New York scamming people. That's one kind of scam. But then there's the almost legal scams. I say almost legal because I think this stuff should be illegal, but it's somehow legal. Zillow is that almost legal scam. So when you go to Zillow and shop for homes, I want you to realize that the minute you start shopping, whether you put in your data or not, you either have a digital footprint, unless your security settings are just, you know, world class, you know, you work for the CIA, then the site's not going to work very well. You're going to be known. They know your email address, even if you're not logged in. They know who you are, even if you're not logged in. And when you go to Zillow and use that website for anything, you're going to be spammed. You're going to be texted. You're going to be called directly or indirectly from those searches. You can unsubscribe from emails. You're going to be resubscribed, even though you didn't ask to be resubscribed. And I know they'll say, oh, this doesn't happen. Yeah, right. I've done this as a consumer. Anything I talk about on this show that affects consumers, I have gone on some browser I never use that's not attached to me, created a profile, and tested it like I'm a new person. Trust me when I say Zillow is trying to sell you a home. They're trying to get in the middle. They're like pharmaceutical middlemen. There's the pharmaceutical manufacturer who makes the insulin that you desperately need to survive. There's the middleman who takes it from the pharmaceutical manufacturer, and then they give it to or sell it to or process it to the pharmacy. And in the process of the pharmaceutical manufacturer, the middleman, and the pharmacy, the cost of your insulin doubles, okay, or triples or quadruples. So the thing that happens that people, yes, is Zillow a great website? Do 42% of all home searches occur on Zillow? Yeah, if I'm marketing to sell your home and you've hired me to list it, then I better get Zillow right, because no matter how much I say on this particular program, video, or podcast, a lot of people are using Zillow that aren't watching this kind of data, that don't realize that their data is being sold and then transferred and then sold. And your phone's ringing off the hook because you use sites like Zillow. The average real estate team or like my website at housedog.com, I mean, we're not, we control our data. Our data about you is gold. We don't want anyone else to have it. We don't want to give it to an outside party because we don't want someone to take our data and then sell against us. So when you're using the local expert's website, whether it be mine or another agent or even a smaller company, you know, we're almost all of us are going to control our data because we want to be the one calling you. We want to be the one interacting with you. But with Zillow, they're going to send it out to three or four agents. They're going to refer it out in their Zillow program. They have a program called Zillow Flex. And what they do is they charge real estate agents 30 or 40% of the commission the agent gets, which drives up your fees. Like, if you think, if you just contacted someone like me locally and said, instead of using Zillow, I want to use you, Brian, and I just meet you one-on-one from this video, I don't have any cost associated with generating this business, so I can give you a better deal. And that's a third of the commission, roughly, give or take, going to some party that you don't really know when you start the process. That's what Zillow's trying to do. But the bigger issue is it's making your phone ring 10 times a day. It's giving you unwarranted, unwanted text messages. It's giving you lots of contact. And then it's being sold to a mortgage company and a title company. And I don't know exactly what all they do with it. But by the time you get finished with it, your phone never stops ringing and you're driven nuts. So when I say Zillow is a scam, it's not necessarily, quote, illegal, but you are unwittingly giving them permission to badger and annoy the heck out of you. So I want you to be aware of that as you shop for homes. Be smart about shopping. Be smart about your research. If you're going to use Zillow, and I agree it's a very well put together, quality amount of data website, make sure you're doing it from a browser. Like, if I use Chrome, but I don't use Safari, so I go to Safari, or I use it from a different computer so that I'm not being tracked and manipulated. And just because you're on Zillow doesn't mean you're seeing everything either. You're being shown what they think is most likely to be clickbait, this little thing right here. They want you to click, and then that way they can sell you. And when that process starts, the behavioral analytics of that, what ends up happening to people is unwittingly the experience that you have online, what you see in ads, what you see in terms of listings, how they're ordered and displayed starts to get manipulated, so you don't get the real perspective of the market. And to not make this into a sales pitch. That's the important part of having a quality experienced real estate agent. Someone like me, there's many of us out there that have sold thousands of houses that understand the market and can't be manipulated by the web scams, which are the big marketing companies who want your data and want to use it to sell you up the river. My website's housedog.com. We're going to try to do this show once a week, roughly 30 minutes or less. And we're going to do 4 or 5 points a week of really good, helpful data to help you buy real estate, sell real estate, invest in real estate, own real estate, not be screwed by the mortgage market, and really have the data to know what's going on right now and how to deal with it so that you can put more equity in your pocket. If you'd like to reach out to me, just call me at 843-343-4141 directly on my cell phone or visit my website, housedog.com. Get your free home value equity analysis right now. Housedog.com, just click on the sell tab and have a great week.